Good evening, students. Today we will look into the last topic of this macroeconomics that we have to cover. And here we'll discuss the most important chapter of your macroeconomic syllabus, determination of income and employment. Now, what happened in the early 1930s, let me start with this. This chapter has 12 marks and you have to, in your reference book, the chapter is perhaps divided into three chapters. So we are taking the whole thing in a lot. Under this topic, the whole topic will be covered by us, and when you open your book, whatever book you have, if you have a reference book, then it is divided into three parts. So you will understand what we have to do. We have to learn about what is aggregate demand and what is aggregate supply. In the early 1930s, there happened a great depression in USA and in West European countries. Before that period, most of the theories, economic theories, were actually based on the classical thought, or what we call the microeconomic theories. But when this Great Depression took place in the early 1930s, from 1929 onwards, what happened? The microeconomists, they started explaining that the forces of demand and supply will bring everything to the right position. But that did not happen. 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, the depression continued. So the then president of USA, Roosevelt, called upon a famous British economist, Lord James Keynes, and he collected empirical data from the market, and then he came out with his theory of this aggregate demand and supply that we are going to study. And this was the main breakthrough, and macroeconomics as a subject developed after the event. So although we are looking at only the introductory part of the whole thing, in our syllabus we have only the introductory part, but still you have to listen to me very carefully, number one. And number two, if some important thing that I speak of, you have to jot it down. So you sit with your pen and paper and listen to what I am saying. After the class is over, you read your book, today only, in the evening, at night, and you will, I hope you will understand everything. Now what happened? There are two terms, aggregate demand and aggregate supply. We'll start with the first slide. Yes, sir. You see, determination of income and employment. What are the things we are going to look into it? What are the things we are going to cover over here? Aggregate demand, what are the components of? So first we'll see the definition of aggregate demand. We'll see the components of aggregate demand. The second term that we will see is aggregate supply, propensity to consume and propensity to save, short-run equilibrium output, then we have this full employment and unemployment, we have excess demand and deficient demand. The very first point, aggregate demand. Start with this. These are the six topics that we are going to cover today. Now, what is aggregate demand? That is the aggregate demand. Yes, sir. Next page. You see. Now, here we will give some time. It is the sum total of expenditure that people plan to make on final goods in the economy at different levels of income in one accounting year. So, aggregate demand. Now, here I have something to explain to you. So, you look at this and listen to what I am saying. Aggregate demand, you see the points. Number one, it is not the demand made by one individual, it is the demand made by all the individuals. So it is the sum total of demand. When you make demand, you pay for it. So we call it expenditure. Don't get confused. The two terms can be used in here in the same sense or in a synonymous way. So it is the sum total of expenditure that people plan to make on final goods in the economy. So number one, it is expenditure. It is the sum total of all the expenditure made by the people of an economy. In national income analysis, we have seen there are two types of goods, intermediate goods and final goods. So here, the expenditure made on intermediate good is not to be taken, mind it. So which is made on the final goods in an economy and at different levels of income. This part is very interesting. We are discussing aggregate demand with respect to the level of income. Now, interestingly, you must understand, aggregate demand can be studied with reference to the price level, which you have already studied in class 11 in microeconomics. You have that demand supply diagram, and when the price changes, the demand supply and the equilibrium price and equilibrium quantity is determined. I hope you remember. Here, Keynes assumed that the price remains same and aggregate demand basically depends on the level of income of the people. This is one important point about aggregate demand. Another important thing about aggregate demand is a word is written there, you see, plan. Again, there are two things that you must distinguish. One is the actual expenditure which people make, and the other one is the expenditure that you plan to make. When we are using the term aggregate demand, then actually we mean the planned expenditure. Expenditure which people plan to make. It is not the actual expenditure that people are making. So what are the important points that you have to note? Number one, it is the sum total of the expenditure. Number two, it is the planned expenditure. So it is being calculated beforehand. Later on, we'll see what happens if actual expenditure and planned expenditure is same or different, then what are the consequences? That we'll see later on. So it is the sum total of the expenditure that people plan to make on the third thing that I said is final goods and services. We are not interested in intermediate goods and services, on final goods and services in an economy at different levels of income, not price. So the fourth point that you have to keep in your mind is that aggregate demand in relation to what Keynes has explained in the Keynesian theory, aggregate demand is to be made related to the income level and not the price level. Clear? Last point that you have to keep in mind is it is calculated for one accounting year, for one accounting. So the whole thing is clear. I am just going through it again. What is aggregate demand? Aggregate demand is the sum total of the expenditure made by all the people. In fact, the planned expenditure made means the expenditure that they plan to make on the final goods and services at different price, income level, not price level, income level. And for one accounting year. Clear? Now, what are the components of aggregate demand? See, the first component we have written consumption expenditure. Consumption expenditure is the first component. If you remember, when I was discussing the national income expenditure method, at that time we had a formula, national income calculated at the gross domestic product calculated at market price. There I wrote private final consumption expenditure. We saw the government final consumption expenditure. Can you recall? Then we saw the gross capital formation and we saw net export. Here the components are the same. The first one is consumption expenditure. Because we are discussing those parts which are important for your exam and which are there in your syllabus. We have to go through only the introductory part. So I am discussing only that part in detail so that you can prepare, because ultimate goal is to prepare for the exam and to gain knowledge also. If you gain knowledge, then preparation will already be on. So consumption expenditure, which you represent by C. This symbolic words are also important, because sometimes when they ask question, when CBSC will ask you the question, they may give you equation C plus I, something like this, AD equal to. So if you remember consumption expenditure is C, then automatically it will be easier for you to deal with the question. So consumption expenditure is symbolized by C. The second term is investment expenditure. You see, investment expenditure I. Okay, fine. The third one is the government expenditure. Government is making expenditure, and there are net export means export minus import. A country, say our country, is making export to other nations. Side by side, other nations are making export to our country. When we are selling goods to them, then we call it export, and naturally when they sell it to us, we call it import. So export minus import will give you net export. So these are the components of aggregate demand. Yes sir, next page. You see, the next term is aggregate supply. We will go into the detail of the components, don't worry. We will go into the detail of the components. But let me give you the introduction of aggregate demand and aggregate supply, because the whole chapter, and when you will open the chapter, you will get these two terms. So you must be in a position to understand the meaning of aggregate demand and aggregate supply. So aggregate supply, it refers to the flow of goods and services planned by producers during an accounting year. It refers to the flow of goods and services planned by the producers during one accounting year, and it is identical to the flow of income. So we call it aggregate supply equal to income. Both are used again. They are identical here for our purpose. We can use them, I will not say synonymously, but both can be, one can replace the other. Or our understanding, our explanation should remain same for both. If aggregate supply is asked or said, whatever is your response, the same response would be there for income also, national income. Alright. Now I will discuss the definition. You see, it refers to the flow of goods and services. There, in aggregate demand, what we have discussed? We have discussed that aggregate demand refers to the expenditure made by the people. Here, what we are saying? We are talking of the total goods and services, all right, which the producers produce. So the two sides when the expenditure made means demand, and when you supply things, you are producer. So income is generated, and the most important word is plan. Planned. Aggregate demand is what people desire to spend. Aggregate supply is again what people plan to produce. People means here producers. Those people who are in production activity, what is their planning? When I will give you one example, you will understand. Sorry. If you see, during Durga Puja, we in our place, we buy new clothes for our children, for the father of the family tries to provide to new clothes to all the members of the family. Okay. So automatically there is demand for, this is just an example to make you understand the whole thing, what is the kind of our discussion. The demand for clothes which come before Durga Puja by the people, they are planning to make expenditure. This is one part of the story. Why this plan word is being used by Keynes, that you have to understand. Now, when the producers produce goods, what happens to them? First, you try to think, in the month of September, people will demand cloths for Durga Puja, in the month of October, or maybe from say 27th September. Then, in the beginning, people will come to the market to buy cloth. When will the seller of cloth in Tripura market or in Agartala market, in Sakuntala road, in Hawker's Corner, here, there, in Hariganga Basak road, at which time, when people will come, will they place the demand? No. 2 months beforehand, maybe in the month of July, August, June, they will place their order to their agents or the dealers, either in Calcutta or Guwahati or Delhi. I'm just framing an example. Now, those people, before supplying it, they must have had already given order to the actual industry, the cloth industry in Surat, Gujarat. You understand? So, the person who is producing cloth in the Surat market, the producer of the cloth, he must have started producing cloth in the month of February or March, which he must have sold to the people in the dealers in or sub-dealers in Delhi or Calcutta or Guwahati by the month of July, August. By then, the demand from this Agartala market must have gone to these markets, sub-dealers and dealers. Then they must have provided the goods by the end of August. Then when in September, people go to buy the goods, or in October, people go to buy the cloth for celebration of this Durga Puja, then automatically they will be able to provide it. So, what happens? The producer is planning, in my example, producer is planning beforehand in the month of March how much to produce. The whole chapter you will be able to get an idea what we are going to discuss over here. Now, the producer in the month of February, March, he is planning to produce. See, it refers to the flow of goods and services planned by the producers during an accounting year. So they are planning it beforehand. Maybe in the month of December or January they started planning. Oh, Durga Puja aega, wahan se order aega Bengal se, Tripura se aega. Like this, they must have started planning. Then they started production out of their past experience. Now suddenly, for some reason, Maybe the weather is, like a few years back, the weather was very harsh. It was raining all around. You must have remembered. And people were not able to come out to buy their clothes. Then actual demand. Now you understand the difference between plan and actual. Everyone is planning. You are planning. Your parents are planning. My parents are planning. Everyone is planning to buy the clothes in the month of September or in the beginning of October. After the puja time is over, maybe this year though is corona, is a very nice example. So all the planning, suppose this pandemic comes in the month of, had come in the month of June, already started beginning in the beginning of this year, but suppose it started in August, then those people in Surat, they produce the goods according to their planning. Either the goods are with them or in Calcutta or something. And when after 2-3 months the time comes, now from Calcutta they will call here the businessman. Ki dada, Ashen. Then they will know, dada, this year though there is this corona pandemic. So many people are not coming out of their houses. Some are buying. So, you don't need. So, planning, actual plan, goods are already produced. Actual demand, less. Opposite may also happen. Sometimes people are very happy, the weather is fine, everything is going nice, everyone is earning a lot of money. So, the producers are producing according to their plan, depending on their experience of the last few years. But when it comes to the market, everyone is going to buy 2 pieces of cloth in place of 1. So demand increases, supply falls short. You understand? Both ways the problem may happen. This will be there in the next chapter, means in your reference book. But I want you to think everything in totality, because the whole unit of this chapter, of this topic, carries 12 marks, and your understanding must cover all parts. So don't think it. Normally I have seen students think first chapter, this is one chapter, that is another chapter. Sorry, here these 3 chapters or 2 chapters you have to study in one unit. That is the first thing you have to understand. While reading the first one, you might have to refer to the third one. While reading the third one, you might have to refer to the first part of the analysis. So, aggregate supply and aggregate demand is very clear to you. It refers to the flow of goods and services planned by producers during an accounting year. It is identical to the flow of income. Aggregate supply is equal to national income. This is clear. Here, you have to keep in mind, we are talking of what producers are planning to produce, what the people are planning to buy in case of aggregate demand, and not actually what is produced or what is purchased. Clear? Yes, sir. Next one. Now, here you see what you have done here. The relationship between aggregate demand and national income. Aggregate supply and national income, you will get it there in the book. The equilibrium condition, you see, we will discuss the components after we finish this part. We will discuss the components one by one. What happens, you see, in the horizontal axis we are plotting income. In the vertical axis we are plotting aggregate expenditure, and the income national income line or the income line or the aggregate supply line is a straight line making a 45 degree angle with the horizontal axis. income increases at a constant rate. Why it is a straight line for making a 45 degree angle? Because income increases at a constant rate. Income increases at a 20, 40, 60, 80, 100, 120, maybe 100, 200, 300, 400, 500. Because Keynes assumed that here in this short run analysis, national income does not change in a haphazard way. 1 year it's 100 million US dollar, next year it would be 500 million US dollar, next year again in the third year it will be 50 million, not like this. Because we are looking at the whole economy, overall there may be some ifs and buts in the economy. There may be some problem in some parts of the economy, some pockets of the economy, but overall economy, it has been observed by Keynes that the overall economy works in a pattern. And since it works in a pattern, so the national income he assumes will increase at a constant rate. Alright. So the national income or the income line or the aggregate supply line is making a 45 degree angle. You see there Y line, OY. OY is the income line. It is making a 45 degree angle and it is a straight line because it has been assumed here that national income increases at a constant rate. Aggregate demand is again a positively sloped curve. You see C plus I, aggregate demand is C plus I. Now, the point where the two meet, aggregate demand and aggregate supply, that gives us the equilibrium point E. And if we draw a line below it, you see, perhaps it's 40. National income is 40. The total output produced amounts to rupees 40, whatever unit is there, US dollar, Indian rupee, so many crores, 40 crores, US dollar, 40 million, US dollar, whatever. That unit is not important for us. We have to understand the point where the aggregate demand and the aggregate supply meets, that point will give us the equilibrium level of aggregate demand and aggregate supply. This is one part of our discussion, aggregate demand. What is aggregate demand? What are the components of aggregate demand? Then we have this aggregate supply. What is it? We don't have to discuss later on when you go to your colleges and you will study economics. There you will read much deeper things. But for the time being in your syllabus, you have to go through only the introductory part. And here the definition of aggregate supply, which I have explained to you just now, is to be understood by you. Alright. So, aggregate demand, aggregate supply, the two meet here and we get the equilibrium. Next class, we will discuss the components of aggregate demand, the consumption and other things, expenditure. For the time being, you read that part, aggregate demand supply. And you also go through the equilibrium explanation. Why aggregate demand curve is positively sloped, what this, that, I will explain tomorrow. By then, go on studying your lessons. Best of luck and stay safe. Alright? Shalom.